Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California, a live and interactive garden show where we talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. We are live on the air and you can call in with your questions about your garden or garden pests or plants you want to grow or anything about your garden. The number is 800-339-1193. My name is Jerry Turney. I'm your host and instructor. And if you have a question about your garden, if you had a problem with plant material, or if there's something you're interested in growing, or any question about your garden at all, call up and hopefully I can answer it. Our textbook is the Sunset Western Garden book, and so a lot of answers can be found in this book. It's got a lot of nice sections, and I just I'd like to, this semester particularly, I'm trying to show a book or more books. So not maybe a book every show, but more books. This is a book I purchased some time ago. It's a rather large book. Most of you won't be interested in purchasing this book. It's called Flora. It's similar to the Western Garden book in that it's an encyclopedia. This is a very large book. It's probably in excess of 1,000 pages. And it's in an encyclopedia form. It actually covers more species than the Western Garden book. It's a much, much bigger book. And let's see, I'll tell you a couple. Over 20,000 plants are listed in this book. So that's a lot of plants. And they call themselves the Gardener's Bible. It's, of course, many contributors helped write this book. And I'm trying to see who actually published it, because I haven't looked at it. Here's a list of all the contributors. And you can see that there's quite a few contributors. Let me just push these plants out of the way. Here's their contributors. And it's basically, here's the contents. You've got plants A to Z. So they talk about all sorts of plants and has how to use the book. It comes with two CDs right here. So you can load it on your computer as well. And probably, I haven't done that yet. I should have, but I haven't yet. So I purchased this because, well, I'm a botanist and a mycologist and a plant pathologist, and this is the kind of book that I have on my shelf, and I have quite a few books that a lot of home gardeners may not purchase, but this is the kind of book you could probably find at the Arboretum of Los Angeles County in their library. So if you wanted to take a look at this book, I think they may have a copy. I'll ask. We'll find out later. We'll ask, because our guest today will be Frank McDonough from the Los Angeles County Arboretum, and I'll ask Frank if they have a copy of this book. It's a nice book, let's just, I'm going to leave it right here for now. The other thing that we have this morning is we have a mystery genus, which we did last week, and we had a couple callers call in, correctly identifying the genus as aloe or aloe. I had three different species of aloe. One of them was a little different than the genuses normally, but these three... right here. Let's see if we can get a look at them. This is our mystery genus. All three of these are species or hybrids within a genus. If you recognize, now I've dropped one of my tags, and if I lose the tags, I won't know the name. Okay, we'll take a look at this one here. This is rather typical of the genus. Here are the flowers for the genus, and I'll say that this genus is also the name genus for the family. And you can see it. Now, the leaves are formed in a rosette. It is a succulent. You can see that it has thick, fleshy leaves. You can propagate this by just breaking the leaves off and setting them in a flat or in a pot, and they'll root and grow a new plant. Or you can take cuttings. This one is a species. This one here is actually a spore from a hybrid, I believe. And again, you can see that it's got these small succulent leaves. These plants are used often in bowls of succulents. And here's another one that's a little unusual. It's a little different than the genus normally is. This is a real rosette of leaves, very thick and fleshy. Of course, the whole genus is that way. And here's the flower that already bloomed right here, and the flowers are all dried up now. So here's our mystery genus. If you can recognize this genus, it's a rather famous genus and if I tell you why, then you'll know the genus. But there we go. There's our, see if I can put these where we can draw your attention to them again later.
This one needs to go like that.
There you go. You can see basically all three of them there. That's our mystery genus of the day. And the reason I picked that genus to highlight today is because it is an important genus. There were some important scientific discoveries within this genus, and there's an important metabolic pathway. Here's your tip, or your clue, is that there's an important metabolic pathway in plants that's named after this genus. So if you know a little bit about biochemistry in plants, then you may know this genus also. And the question is, are these succulents? Yes, they are succulents, but they are not cactus. And we haven't lectured on cactus yet, but I probably will be lecturing on cactus in the coming weeks. And it's important to note that, and I'll just throw this out because I mention it frequently to many people, that cactus are succulents, but not all succulents are cactus. And these are, of course, not cactus. They aren't in the cactus family, the Cactaceae, and they're not one of the genera within that family, so they're not cactus. So here we have this huge book, and I'm going to actually very quickly, before anyone calls, I want to be on the page for this genus. I looked it up before the show started and just refreshed my memory. Let's see. Oh, here we go. There it is. I'm just going to set this over to the side. And when someone calls, then I'll bring it up and we'll talk about this genus in a little more depth. You know, this genus has it's a big genus. There's quite a few species within the mystery genus. And you can use them, you know, they're all succulents, so they make nice plants to put in a bowl full of succulents to have on an outdoor table, on a patio. They make nice plants in a rock garden, or some will probably be pretty decent ground covers. Although, you know, a lot of these succulents grow rather slowly, so if you want to have a ground cover, you know, cover a lot of area, you're going to have to grow, buy a lot of plants to start with. But today, we're going to talk about integrated pest management. Last week, we talked about insects, and that was really the first part of this lecture, is to understand all the insect groups, particularly the sucking insects and the chewing insects, because they, now that's not really a taxonomic, so taxonomically inclined, but there are those insects that have like a little tube for a mouth part and they puncture the leaf or the stem or some part of the plant tissue and they suck juices out. Then there are the insects that chew, and things like grasshoppers and beetles and caterpillars that chew. And, you know, the way you control those two insects can be quite different because the way they behave is different. And if you want to get them off your plants and protect your plants, then you need to use techniques that are appropriate for whatever's damaging your plant. But let's talk about integrated pest management. Integrated pest management, it's important to note that the genesis of the term and the concept of integrated pest management, back in the late 40s and into the 1950s, a lot of growers, a lot of farms just sprayed on a calendar basis. They would say, well, it's March 1st, I'll just, you know, go out and spray the crop. And they used a lot of fairly harsh chemicals that had long residual activities, things like DDT and other insecticides that would linger on the plants and be effective for months. And in fact, some of these things got into the soil and they were still active for years later. Then there was a move to, you know, use insecticides that were less toxic, insecticides that had short residuals, so they broke down rapidly in the environment and you didn't have these long-term problems. But along with that came the concept of integrated pest management, which meant you didn't go out and spray based on the calendar, that you sprayed based on the biology of the pest and how you bring everything together to control the pest, not just rely on a chemical control. But I see we have our first caller. Let's go to our first caller. Tatlin, calling from North Hills. I hope I pronounced your name correctly. Are you there?
Hello?
Hello, what's your question?
I wanted to take a stab at the question.
Oh, the...
And I'm wondering if it's Echeveria.
No, it's not Echeveria, but that's a good guess.
Hello?
I don't know if you can hear me directly on the phone. I think that you need to turn up the volume on your TV now. And I'll just tell you that Echeveria is a very good guess. It's very similar to Echeveria, and you almost got it. You seem to know your succulents a little bit, but this is not Echeveria. This is a different genus. But good try, and we'll talk about Echeveria too in a minute. But good try. It's very similar to Echeveria. I didn't bring any Echeveria because I didn't want to confuse anybody there. I actually had some Echeverias on the side there, and I thought, well, I'll bring them in and compare and contrast, but then I'll just, you know, I thought, let's just look at one genus at a time. But good guess, but not right. So let's back to IPM. So the thing about IPM is historically growers used to just spray on the 1st and the 15th or whatever, based on a calendar, on a time scale, rather than the biology of the pest. And they often didn't take into consideration other things, cultural things that you could do to prevent or suppress the pest population. So they came up with the concept of IPM, or integrated pest management. And central to that concept is let's take a look so I don't leave any out, is to set an action threshold. Now, for most home gardeners, you don't really, you know, this isn't as applicable to a backyard garden as it is to a farm, because maybe in your garden, your threshold is really no insect pests in your garden, or very few, or no damage, because if you're growing ornamentals, you don't want them to look bad. You want them to look, you know, vigorous and healthy, and you don't want a bunch of holes in the leaves. You don't want the plants all chewed up. Often for ornamentals, the threshold is really very, very low, almost no insects at all. But in food production, in a farm, whether you're growing grapes or wheat or corn or whatever you're growing, you can live with a few insects on the crop if it's not going to reduce your yield. So the concept was that you set an action threshold, which means how many insects can I tolerate in the crop without having any yield loss, without losing money, and at which point do I need to go out and take action and do something to prevent yield loss? And so that could be the number of insects per leaf, if you're looking at aphids or something like that, and you go out and you're monitoring the aphid population. So that's the other key part of IPM, is monitoring. You want to go out and count the insects. And, of course, there'll be some way to do that that's reproducible. So every week or twice a week or however often is required, you go out and you sample your farm or the field. You can often use a sweep net. You sweep back and forth. You do 3 sweeps or you do 5 sweeps or some set number. Then you look in your net and you see how many of the pests you find. Or you look, just collect leaves and you find out how many are on the leaf. And when you reach a certain amount per leaf or a certain amount per acre, or however you define the population of insects, when you reach that point, then you know, okay, if the population goes higher than that, I'm going to have a yield loss. I'm going to lose money. So now I've got to go out and spray. So just those two first things, setting your action threshold and monitoring, allows you to delay your first applications or have a longer period between applications, because you're not spraying when the pest isn't there or the pest population is so low that it doesn't require any action. So those two concepts are really important. It's setting an action threshold and monitoring and identifying the pest. The other thing is prevention. Well, you know, what can you do to prevent the problem in the first place? That could be the selection of your cultivar. What type of plant are you going to select? You know, it's not all corn is not the same. So you can, boy, there's some smart people out there today. I got to tell you, here's our Gibson's guess is Crassula. Here is our email question, and there you go. They've got it already. These three plants are in the genus Crassula, and I might as well talk about them right now. The first one is Baby's Surprise. This one right here is called Baby's Surprise. I'm going to move these out of the way and move this one over. This is Crassula Baby's Surprise. This is a spark from Baby's Necklace, which is a hybrid. So this is not a wild naturally occurring species. This is a spark off of a hybrid. And it says, differs in its smaller rounded leaves and upright stems. So baby's necklace would probably have slightly larger leaves and maybe be a little more pendulant and not so upright. And the point is that there are about 300 species within the genus Crassula. So, and they hybridize fairly easily, and so you can cross different species. And then sporting is when you get a branch off a plant that's different from the rest of the plant. You take that cutting off, then you can root it or you can propagate it somehow. Now this one here, let's take a look at this one right here. This is Crassula mesembryanthemopsis. So mesembryanth, of course, is the family Mesembryanthaceae, which is the things like ice plant. That's the ice plant family. So I guess this does slightly resemble some of the ice plants. Dwarf. It's described here on the sticker or on the tag. Dwarf rosettes blend with quartz gravel habitat. Clusters of fragrant white flowers in center of rosette. So this is a little different than most of the Crassula that's having a rosette. Usually they grow kind of more upright on a stem. So this one's a little different than most of the genus. But I kind of like this one. This one's real nice. It's a real nice. These make really nice window plants on an eastern exposure, or if you have a southern or western exposure, and you've got an awning so they don't get direct sun in the hottest part of the summer. They do take full sun. But they can still get a little too much hot sun in the late afternoons. Now, this last one is Crassula coralita. This is a hybrid, a Kinnich hybrid between Crassula susannae and Crassula falcata. So the coral pink flowers on 4 to 5 inch inflorescences, compact rosettes of 4 ranked gray leaves. So you can see here, what's nice about this one is it's flowering. So you can see these little flowers. This is typical. These are typical of the Crassula, these teeny little, often pink, and kind of almost tubular. They're very, very small. You really can't see them very well just right there unless you had it right in your hand. They're little tiny tubular flowers. And so Crassula is a fairly big genus. They make really nice plants for windowsills or if you have a greenhouse window over your kitchen sink, something like that. You can go away. Oh, I see we got a kind of close-up. Let's see if I can show you some of these flowers that are open. Let's see here. If you can see, it's kind of, they're little tiny tubular flowers. They're really nice. So Crassula. So why is Crassula so famous? I said that there was a famous metabolic pathway named after Crassula. And that pathway is called the Crassula acid metabolism, CAM. Crassula acid metabolism is a way for plants to carry on photosynthesis during the day without losing water. So they actually complete the photosynthesis process at night. They store some of the energy as a chemical, and then at night they finish it. So they don't have to have their stomata, the little openings on the backs of the leaves, open during the day, which causes water loss. So it turns out that this pathway is present in succulents and cactus and things like that. And they're referred to as CAM plants, Crassula acid metabolism. And that was discovered in the genus Crassula. And I don't know offhand which species they used when they figured out that pathway. And it is used in a lot of succulent plants. And it saves water. Basically, it saves water for them. And you can imagine plants that are succulent and grow in arid or desert regions need to have ways to save water, and the CAM pathway is how they do that in this particular group. But back to integrated pest management, and prevention is really, really important. And prevention could be, now you're looking at anything you can do to try and prevent the pest from becoming a problem during the growing season. That could be planting date. It could be how you fertilize. It could be how often you water. It could be the cultivar you select. You know, generally, anybody who grows plant material would like to grow plants that are resistant, and so you don't have to go out and spray with chemicals. You can just have a natural way of controlling it. And I'll digress in a minute, but control is the next thing you can do. And once you've monitored and you've identified and you have your action threshold and you find the pest and you say, well, I want to control it now. So now you look at all, you look into your toolbox and you look at how can I control it. Now you can start with chemicals that have the least impact on beneficials. You always want to try not to disrupt any biocontrol that's already going on in your garden or on a farm, and use chemicals only when you have to, and start with chemicals that have the least impact. So I think I'll probably just go ahead and we'll pull up some chemicals and start talking about those in a minute. Let's take a look at chemicals. Now, so some people have called up and asked questions in the past, and we've talked about some of these chemicals a little bit, but let's take a look at what we got here. Now, this one's empty, and I brought in a whole bunch of stuff to talk about it. Now, the first things I always use when I have an insect pest that is becoming a problem on plant material is I think, can I control this with either oils or soaps? And they're very, very good for the sucking insects. Things like aphids, mealybug. Now, if you take a look at this, this is Safer Insect Killing Soap. And here it is. This one's empty. I've used it up. It's very effective also on mites. Now, where do I use it? I grow Phalaenopsis orchids in my kitchen, and they get mealybugs on them all the time. And this is ready to spray right out of the bottle. So now I'm going to save this bottle because I'm going to go buy a concentrate now and use this as a spray bottle for soap. If you want, you can just use dishwashing soap. It's very, very effective at controlling the sucking insects. But this is Safer Insecticidal Soap. And if you look down at the active ingredient, it says potassium salts of fatty acids. Don't let that confuse you. Fatty acids are soaps. That's what soap is made out of, usually some type of salt of a fatty acid. Now here's Safer Rose and Flower Insect Killer. And it is a potassium salt of fatty acids, again. Now, if you notice, this one says insect killing soap, and this one says rose and flower insect killer, and really they're the same thing. So these are ready to spray out of the bottle. Here's another one. Oh, that's oil. Let's pull up some more and see what we've got here. A lot of this stuff is all dusty and dirty. Here's Safer Insecticidal Soap. Let's keep talking about soap. Now, this is a concentrate, so if you're going to be spraying your garden outdoors, you'd be much better off. Don't buy one of these ready-to-spray bottles, because this is only going to spray one part of a bush if you wanted to spray, you know, a large area. Like if you had a lot of rose bushes and you had a lot of aphids, like behind me you see in that picture, those are rose aphids. If you want to spray your whole garden, get a concentrate and then use a hose-end sprayer. My favorite is the orthodilus spray, just because it's so simple to use. You don't have to measure this. You just put it in the bottle, put the top on it, and set it the dial to the dilution rate that you want to use based on the label. Always read the label. It's so important to read the label. Don't ignore the label. Read the whole label. And then correctly apply the material, because even soaps, you could damage plants if you use it at too high a concentration. You might burn. So those are soaps. There's Safer Insecticidal Soap is one of the more common ones you can purchase. Now then there's the oils. And here's one that's ready. This is meant to be hooked up to a hose. This is All Seasons Spray Oil, and the active ingredient, it says, I'm trying to see what oil they actually use. And this is just one of the short chain paraffin oils. Ready to use in that you can hook up a hose to it and turn it on, and it will dilute it as it sprays. So this would spray a large area in a garden. It's concentrated in here, and it's diluted by this, by the nozzle and the spray. So this is spray oil. Oils smother insects and cause them to die. And let's see. And here is another oil. This is Sunspray Ultrafine. This is year-round pesticidal oil. It's a paraffinatic oil. It's a paraffin oil. Let's take a look at this one. You can see it's quite dirty. I don't use them very often. I don't spray unless I really have to. But if you have a lot of aphids on your rose bushes, or aphids on your citrus, or on your fruit trees, or you've got maybe thrips on azaleas, or whatever it is, these oils are pretty effective. So Safer, Ultrafine, very popular. There's also Volk oil and there's neem oil. And neem oil has some antifungal activity as well, so it can be used for powdery mildew. But this is a concentrate, and so you'd put this in a hose-in sprayer. And again, I like that ortho dialer spray. It's just so simple to use. You just click it to the right dilution rate. It goes anywhere from a half an ounce up to 8 ounces per gallon. You pour some, you know, maybe a little bit in there and hook it up, turn on the hose, and blast away. The pump sprayers are fine too, but I find that they're slow. So you fill up a pump sprayer, maybe a 3-gallon pump sprayer, pump it up, and you spray a little mist on them. That works. It's just a little slow. So if you've got a big job, then I use the hose-in sprayers. Now let's see what else we've got in my bag of tricks. And we've talked about oils and soaps. And then, let's see, we've got all sorts of stuff. I want to look at all the organic stuff first, the non-toxic materials first. Okay, we're getting closer here. You can see I got a lot of this junk. Here we go, and that one's not on the market anymore, but I'll show it to you anyway. Okay, so the next one to look at is BT. Now, BT is specifically for caterpillars, and this is, it just says caterpillar killer. And the active ingredient in this is a bacteria called Bacillus thuringiensis, BT. So BT is eaten by caterpillars. You mix this up with water, you spray it on your plant that's being eaten by a caterpillar, and then when they eat it, they stop feeding, and they will die within a couple days. It is non-toxic to everything else. It's non-toxic to mammals. It's organically labeled. The oils and soaps are also organic. So if you're an organic, if you want to be organic, you can use oils and soaps. If you have a caterpillar problem, you can use BT. Now, there are some strains of BT that will also control some flies, like midges. And sorry about that. So that's Bacillus thuringiensis. Very effective for caterpillars. Now, what are the most common caterpillars you're going to deal with? If you're a vegetable grower, if you like to have a vegetable garden, and you grow tomatoes, you're almost certainly going to get the vegetable hornworm, the tomato hornworm, or the tobacco hornworm. There are two hornworms that get on tomato, and this is very effective at controlling the hornworms on tomatoes because they are caterpillars, and of course they turn into sphinx moths. And moths are one of the more common pests that you get, and there's a sphinx moth behind me. And here we go with the next material, and it's this is a pyrethrin, and this is from EasyGone, multi-purpose yard and garden insect killer. And if you look at the active ingredient, it says pyrethrin, and it's 2.5%. Let's turn this around and take a look at it. And you see, you look at something like this, and you wonder, well, what the heck is it? You've got to look down here at the very bottom, right there, and read the active ingredient. And you can't read it. I know you can't see it unless they come in really, really close. But you can see that it says pyrethrin. Now, pyrethrins are made from a chrysanthemum. And chrysanthemums, let's take a look. Here we got oils. We got pyrethrin. It's made from chrysanthemum cinerea folia. It's a difficult one for me to read. There are neurotoxins that attack the nervous system of all insects. Most insects are highly susceptible to pyrethrins, so quite low concentrations are applied. Pyrethrins are quite non-toxic to most animals, mammals, making them among the safest of all insecticides to use. If you're not getting good control with soaps and oils, then the next step up to a little stronger material would be a pyrethrin. They rapidly break down after application. They have very short residual activity in the garden. There are some things that are beneficials that have good natural tolerance, like lace wings, but unfortunately it does kill parasitic wasps, and predatory mites and beetles are very susceptible, and it's sold under a variety of names. This one is, of course, EasyGone, multi-purpose yard and garden, but Ambush and Pounce. So pyrethrins are available from many manufacturers. I'm not trying to endorse anyone's particular product. So are you having more pests in your garden? So give us a call if you've got some pests and you want to ask me about how to control one of them. I can recommend one of these products for you. So that's pyrethrin. Now, they also make pyrethroids. Pyrethroids are synthetic versions of pyrethrins. Pyrethrins are generally, you know, this is an organic material. You can use this. It's labeled organic. So it's not, it's because it's from a natural product. It's made from a plant. So for that reason, it's considered organic. Now, the next one that's also organic, so far everything's been organic and fairly non-toxic or low, very low toxicity. This is spinosad. This is Monterey Garden insect spray. And again, you look at the label, and unless you look at the active ingredient, you're not going to know what this is. It's, you know, we haven't moved up to the broad spectrum insecticides yet. But anytime you purchase a product, take a look at the label and look at the active ingredient. And right down here it says active ingredient, spinosad, a mixture of spinosin A and spinosin D, 0.5%. Spinosad is actually one of your better products. It says right here, contains spinosad, you see? So spinosad controls a lot of insects, and particularly chewing insects. So you can use it on vegetables, you can use it on your ornamentals, it's organic, it's very low toxicity. It's made from a soil bacteria, from an actinomycete, and it's very good for controlling both caterpillars or chewing insects. Spinosad doesn't work very good on sucking insects. So if you spray things like aphids or mealybug or scale, you won't get good control with this. This is for grasshoppers, beetles, caterpillars, and leaf miners. This is labeled also for leaf miners, but you got to get it on before they get inside the leaf. So that's spinosad, and spinosad is a very good product. It's good stuff if you need to use it. Now, let's take a look at a couple other things. I didn't bring in any 7. Now, if we move, if you're still not getting good control, and some insects are very, very difficult to control. They are things like scale insects. Scale insects are the most difficult to control, and turning off my phone, it's bugging me. But anyway, so scale insects are very hard to control. If you start in the spring with oils and soaps, you should be able to get some pretty good control or keep the population down on your scale. But a lot of times scales are very difficult to control. You find yourself spraying rather frequently with oils and soaps, and you're not getting the adults, you're just getting the immature stages, the crawling stage. So what you need to do, if you really want to get control and you're tired of all the scale problem, is hit them with a stronger material. And things like, there's two broad groups. There's the organophosphates and the carbamates, and they both work the same way. They are cholinesterase inhibitors. They inhibit an enzyme, which then kills the insect. And we'll take a look at one that's no longer on the market. It's diazinon. This is diazinon. You might have heard of diazinon a long time ago. Now, this is just leftover. It's not illegal to have it. You can use it up if you still have it in your garage or if you have a little bit left over. But it's been highly restricted now. It's no longer approved for homeowner use in terms of sales. But again, if you've got it, you can use it up. But this is an example of an organophosphate. The problem was that there was a lot of bird kills with this that would be sprayed on lawns at golf courses or at parks or cemeteries. And then birds would land on the grass and feed, and then you'd end up with a large amount of those birds dying from the exposure to diazinon. So diazinon was pulled from homeowner use. The first, it was banned for inside the home use. Then it was banned for outside the home use. Now it has a very restricted label, only for ag use and only for a few crops. So the amount of diazinon being used now is a fraction of what used to be used. It's used only on a few crops, and it's very, very limited. But I have a little tiny bit left, and I almost never use it. The only time I use it is when I get Argentine ants into some of my orchid pots, and then I'll mix up a little bit and drench the pot with it, because otherwise I just have such a hard time getting those ants out of the pot. And this is the time of year they love to get in there. You know, a lot of times I'll try soaps first. I'll hit the pot with soaps. I'll soak the pot. I'll do all sorts of things to try and get the ants out. If that still doesn't work, I go get the diazinon. I just have a little bit left. When I use that up, it's all gone. So I don't have any 7. You know, the organophosphate you can still buy is malathion. And I don't know if you can still get Dursban. I think Dursban's gone as well. But those are organophosphates. And so the other group were the carbamates, and that would be, and the one you can still buy is called 7. 7 is a broad-spectrum insecticide. The problem with these broad-spectrum insecticides, chemical insecticides, is when you use them, you kill everything. You kill all the beneficials. You kill your target pest. You bring the pest problem under control immediately. But now you've got a problem, is that other pests that used to be controlled by everything else you killed become a problem. So you end up often controlling one pest, but making something else that wasn't a problem a big problem. So you have to always be careful. Only use these broad-spectrum materials when you really feel you have to use it, that you're not getting good control on the others. So, you know, the oils and soaps and the spinosad and the pyrethrins, they have the least impact on beneficial insects. And so if you use them, you often don't have these boomerang effects where suddenly you control your aphids, but you killed all the other things that were eating the mites. Now you got a huge mite problem. So now you're spraying from the mites. So be careful with the broad-spectrum materials. They're really, really difficult to deal with. Now, the other thing that's kind of a nice material that I recommend a lot of times is the Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub, and this is the homeowner packaging. The active ingredient is called imidacloprid. Imidacloprid is a neonicotinoid, which means it has the same mode of action as nicotine. Nicotine used to be used in many different products as a pesticide because nicotine is fairly toxic and it kills insects fairly easily. But there are no more nicotine-based pesticides on the market in California. They've all been removed. I don't know that they were banned. I think they were voluntarily pulled by the manufacturers. And now imidacloprid's out. It's been out for quite some time. It is used in a lot of products. It's used in a product called Advantage for dogs and cats to control teas and flicks. I know it's a little controversial. Some people think that there's been reports of allergic reactions in dogs and cats to imidacloprid. And so whether you want to use that on your dog and cat, a lot of people do it and don't have a problem, but some people have reported problems with that. This product, of course, is meant for treating ornamentals. And the nice thing about it is you just drench you mix this with water, water the plant with it, so it's a root drench. It'll be taken up into the plant, and it will control all the sucking and chewing insects for 12 months or even longer. I've had reports of it controlling insects on citrus as long as 3 years. So this is the homeowner packaging. It's a Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub. It's 1.5% imidacloprid. If you hire someone to come in and put the same material down, they'll use a label called Merit. Merit is the label for imidacloprid for commercial application for ornamental uses. And it's 75% active ingredient, and it's a powder. And, of course, the manufacturers don't want to sell to homeowners highly concentrated materials. It's no doubt about it, people will poison themselves. They're not trained to use these highly concentrated products. So whenever you go buy homeowner products, you'll see that they're very, very weak and often ready to go out of the bottle or need very little dilution. This is 1.5%. If you're treating a shrub or a tree, you measure the circumference of the trunk of the tree. So you're measuring, you want to treat a 50-foot tree that has a heavy insect infestation. It's too big to spray. This is where this product is actually best used. For large trees where you can't control the insect population, it's damaging the tree or even killing it, and you need to spray it, but it's a huge tree. If you tried to spray it, you'd need a crane with a bucket or some type of cherry picker to go up there and spray that whole tree. You'd get drift all over the place. You'd be spraying half the neighborhood. So all you have to do is do a drench with this. Now, it takes a few months to come up into a big tree. It works much faster on a small shrub. And it takes it up a little faster if you put a little bit of nitrogen in the water with it. So almost any fertilizer would be fine, maybe just at about a quarter strength. And it takes it up fastest in the early spring, so right now. So if you have a tree that every year gets an insect infestation and drips honeydew all over your car that's in the driveway, or creates a problem for you, and we've got quite a few trees like that right now. We have a new psyllid on Tipiwanu. We've got the Myoporum thrips. We've got different psyllids on eucalyptus trees. We've got a tortoiseshell beetle on eucalyptus trees. Those are very hard insects to control because the tree is so big. How do you control it if you have to spray the whole tree and you really can't? So if you just do a root drench with this, the imidacloprid, you'll get a 12-month control. Maybe even you won't even have to do this, but every other year. So every spring or every other spring, you could do a root drench with this on large trees. This particular label is not labeled for edible crops. It is, imidacloprid is sold under a label called Admire, and that's labeled for agricultural use for citrus and grape and avocado and vegetable and quite a few crops. A lot of the oranges grown in California are treated with imidacloprid. It's used extensively, and it's very effective material, and the state uses it actually in some of their quarantine operations, especially for the Asian citrus psyllid. They treat any citrus trees found with Asian citrus psyllid with imidacloprid as a root drench, and then that tree won't have any psyllids on it for at least 12 months. So the idea is to control the psyllids. So this is a pretty good product, especially for large trees and infestations that are really you can't spray. So it also comes as in a rose and flower care, and it's got imidacloprid and it's got a fungicide as well. This is a systemic with that has a fungicide plus an insecticide. I rarely ever use fungicides in my own garden. It's kind of funny because I'm a plant pathologist, and you'd think I would probably control more of my fungal diseases with a product, but I don't. I don't get a lot of fungal diseases. Now, the things like, there are some other, I've talked almost entirely about insects, but there are plant diseases, and some of the more common plant diseases, or one of the most common, is powdery mildew. And powdery mildew has some nice controls. You can control that with just milk and water, about a 50-50 mix of milk and water, as little as 10% milk and water. And you need to spray about once a week for about 3 weeks. And things, you know, if you want to treat squash that are getting powdery mildew or roses that are getting powdery mildew, milk and water works. There's also now potassium bichloride, bicarbonate, I'm not bichloride, potassium bicarbonate from Kellogg. And that is organic and non-toxic, and that's very, very effective. And neem oil is supposed to be effective for powdery mildew as well. I see we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Patlin calling from, Terry calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
Yes. I had a question about insects killing oak trees.
Okay.
I've heard that there has been some insects that kill oak trees, and I wanted to protect my own oak tree. And I was wondering how I can do that.
Okay. I think you may be referring to the gold-spotted oak borer. That's the newest insect that's a problem on oaks. We do have quite a few insects on our native oaks, of course. They're native, and so there's lots and lots of native insects that feed on oaks, but they don't kill them. For the most part, our native insects live in harmony to some extent with oaks. But this is a new pest on oaks down in the San Diego area. I think mostly in the Cleveland National Forest. It's called the gold-spotted oak borer. And I don't know that there's a lot you can do specifically to control that pest. It currently is not in Los Angeles County. I don't even think it's in Orange County. I think it's down south in San Diego County. I don't know how far north it's moved in San Diego County. I'd have to look into that a little more closely. If you do a search on the internet for gold-spotted oak borer, you'd be able to read more about it. The most important thing would be to take care of your oak so the oak tree is as healthy as possible. And that would be how often you water it and what you grow under it and whether you disturb the roots, those kind of things. You know, our native oaks don't need to be watered in the summer. At the most, you water them once a month, and maybe in the winter and the spring. If we had a very, very dry winter with almost no rain, you definitely want to water once a month. You want to water them for maybe 4 to 8 hours one day during the whole month, soak them real good. If the trees are well watered during the winter and the spring, then they naturally resist these types of wood borers that bore into the trunks of the trees. We do have another wood borer that commonly gets into them called the sycamore wood borer. It gets into both sycamores and oaks, particularly the California coast live oak. But that doesn't really cause a whole lot of damage compared to some other wood-boring insects. This gold-spotted oak borer is supposed to be particularly devastating down there where it's killed thousands of oaks. So other than that, you know, once these borers get inside the trunk, there's not a lot you can do. Now, let's see here. Here is one more product that we'll take a look at. This, now I mentioned that you could use neem oil, or you could use milk and water, or the new potassium bicarbonates for powdery mildew. But if, you know, here's a typical fungicide. It's called Fungenex. This is for homeowners. And this is used to control fungal diseases. You could use it for powdery mildew. You could use it for rust on roses. You could use it for black spot on roses. In an ornamental sense, you know, I'm trying to think of all the different, you know, in the spring we get a lot of rain and we get some anthracnose problems. For the most part, though, they just go away when it stops raining, and those are big trees. Like if we get sycamore anthracnose or elm anthracnose, oak anthracnose, they're not the same fungus or pathogen on each case, but they're similar in that they can only infect the leaves when it's wet and rainy, and so as soon as it dries out. So I don't see any point in spraying big trees for anthracnose. It's not really worth the hassle or the expense, and it'll just stop, and the tree will be fine once the wet weather stops. And it always stops. Often it stops too early, and I'm hoping we get some more rain. But if you have a real problem with powdery mildew on your roses or rust on your roses, Fungenex would be good. There's another one called Fungiway. Or you could try the neem oil. The neem oil may be your first choice. It's non-toxic and would probably work fairly well for powdery mildew or the potassium bicarbonate. But rust diseases are particularly difficult to control, and you might consider either Fungenex, Fungiway. There's another one called Daconil. You could also buy these. Are all packaged for homeowners, and that would probably be pretty good. And now let's move on to another group of products, and this is probably one of the more common, and that's herbicides. How do you control some of the weed species that you want to control? This is probably the most common herbicide used. And you could use this. It's very good at killing grasses and herbaceous weeds. It's not good for trees or woody plants. Say you have a poison oak growing on your slope and you want to get rid of it. Now, this doesn't work very good. It'll knock the leaves off, but it won't kill poison oak all that well. You need, you know, there's other things that do that quite well. But this is very good for grasses. This is what I've used in my own yard to kill my lawn, because I got sick of mowing my lawn and I got sick of putting 4 feet of water on my lawn every year. And I decided to save water and save and not run a lawnmower and spew gasoline or exhaust from my lawnmower. I spew exhaust from my car every day, but at least I don't have a lawnmower spewing fumes anymore. So if you're interested in killing your lawn, Roundup is fairly safe material, especially when used correctly. I want to say over, if I didn't say it already, read the label, follow the label. Typically, you want to wear neoprene gloves, you want to wear eye protection, you want to wear a long sleeve shirt, you want to wear pants and shoes. Avoid any unnecessary contact with any of the materials, even the soaps and the oils. They're not 100% non-toxic. Some people may be allergic to it, but you know, there's no reason to let it get on your skin when you're spraying these materials. They can have, you might develop a rash or you might be allergic to it. So read the labels, wear personal protective clothing. And now this one here is a brush killer. And let's see what the active ingredient is. This is the one I wanted to mention. This is ready-to-use brush killer. This is from Easy Gone. You can also get it from Ortho, and it's called Ortho Brush Be Gone. And sometimes it's labeled as Ortho Brush Be Gone Poison Oak Killer. And the active ingredient is triclopyr. And I'm going to say it again. Read the active ingredient. Know what you're buying. Know what you're using in your garden. The active ingredient's right here. It says triclopyr, and it says triclopyr at 0.75%. You see, this is a homeowner packaging, very, very low concentration. This is ready to use right out of the bottle. If you get the Ortho Brush Be Gone, it's a concentrate. You need to spray it on with some type of sprayer. I never use a sprayer that's had herbicide in it to apply any other product. even a just a tiny bit of residual of an herbicide in a sprayer can cause you a lot of problems. This is triclopyr. It's very good for things like woody shrubs and trees that are coming up in a problem, like poison oak. Now let's go to a video clip, and then we'll bring in our guest.
For example, the plant right in front of me, which is in the genus Dazzlerion, is a woody arborescent monocot. It'll eventually get a short woody trunk on it. And northeastern Mexico is very rich in Dazzlerion. There's this species right here, which is Dazzlerion mica huanense. And then over here is Dazzlerion, another species of Dazzlerion, Dazzlerion quadrulatum. And then we have behind us over here, Dazzlerion longissima. These very long leaves, Dazzlerion. So Dazzlerions are well adapted to culture in Southern California. These plants, again, are 5 years old from a one-gallon container. And once established, they require very little irrigation. They can get by on very little water. So they're a very good choice for us in Southern California. Okay. One of the groups of plants that I was very interested in looking at in northeastern Mexico and bringing back to grow in Southern California were oak trees. And you might be surprised to know that Mexico has more oak species than any other place in the world. It's incredibly rich in oaks. And one of the ones we brought back was called Quercus polymorpha. Polymorpha means many-shaped, and it describes the shape of the leaves. The leaves are extremely variable as to their shape. But it's an evergreen oak, and it's done extremely well here. This tree you see behind me is probably almost 30 feet tall. So it's grown up to 30 feet tall from a one-gallon plant that we planted in 2005. So 5 years later, it's a 30-foot-tall plant. 20. So it's a fabulous area as far as the plants are concerned because you have this mingling of a temperate flora with a tropical flora. And 8 years ago or 7 years ago, I went there with some nursery people from Texas, and we spent a couple weeks driving around in northeastern Mexico photographing and collecting seeds of many of the different kinds of plants. I brought the seeds back, I planted them, and then I donated the plants to the Arboretum, and we established what we call the Mexican Garden up near Talac Knoll in the Arboretum in Arcadia. And I'm going to share some of the plants that we've brought back and talk to you about how they've grown and how suitable they are for landscaping here in Southern California.
One, two, three.
Hi, I'm Don Hodel. I work for the University of California here in Los Angeles, and I develop applied research projects and educational programs for the commercial landscape industry in Los Angeles County, a job that I've been doing for about 27 years.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. I'm your host and instructor, Jerry Turney. And today we have with us Frank McDonough from the Los Angeles County Arboretum and Botanic Garden in Arcadia, California. So Frank.
Jerry, how are you doing?
How are you doing?
I'm doing good.
And I guess I forgot to say that Frank was the previous host of this program, and so we always like to bring you back on and see what's new at the Arboretum and
such
what's new with you.
Such memories here. Such memories. Yeah. It's great.
Yeah, you did the show for 4 years?
4 years, yeah. About starting in 2004, I do.
Yeah, so, and people still remember you fondly.
Well, thank you. Thank you. You know, did you see the little video that I brought in just before, a little on the rough side?
Oh, your video with
Don Hodel.
Don Hodel.
You know Don?
I know Don well. Yeah. Don is the extension advisor for Turf and Landscape in Los Angeles County with the University of California Cooperative Extension. Expert on palms, published on, and has published quite a bit on palms.
Well, he's a monocot man per se. I mean, he likes his monocots, palms, yuccas, Dazzlerions, but he also brought in some oaks to the Arboretum from northern Mexico, and these oaks look like they could be very good additions to landscaping in Southern California, in that they're low water use, yet they're resistant to some of the problems like compaction and some of the diseases that the oaks here have trouble with when you try to get them established in a garden. Now, it's always, of course, a good idea to try to start a native oak, but in some conditions you might not be able to do so, in which case you might as well start an oak that's at least close to native or is a low water use plant that is robust and can do a lot of things. And these oaks are very good at that. One of them is a Quercus polymorpha, and it's used extensively in Texas, especially in Austin, where they call it the Monterey oak. Very beautiful. It grows up to 40 feet in a few years.
Oh, that's
a huge rate of growth. Plus, he also brought in a Mexican, a Platanus racemosa, or a Platanus mexicana, excuse me. Going around that Latin stuff. Sorry, everybody out there. I try not to do too much Latin. It's a Mexican plane tree or a Mexican sycamore.
Oh, okay.
And it doesn't have the problems with anthracnose that the native sycamore has.
Yeah, there's also the London plane tree, which is Platanus.
It's a foliage. Right, right.
And that doesn't tend to get the sycamore wood borer or the anthracnose. And they tend, you know.
But they do get mildew.
They all get mildew, and they all get the lace bug, too. So.
You should see this thing. It looks a lot like a California sycamore, except that it tends to have a little bit more, exfoliating bark. But it's really beautiful.
It goes fast. You know, the one thing about our western sycamore, or the some people call it the California sycamore, or the western sycamore, which is Platanus racemosa, is because
of that. I wrote that off.
Well, but it, you know,
I can help you with your problem.
It can be important. It can be important sometimes. It's important to be very specific sometimes when you're talking about.
Absolutely, I'm just
kidding. If people have had a problem with a specific pest or a disease, it's very important if they're looking for a resistant, sometimes a cultivar.
Right.
You know, and a cultivated variety may show resistance, whereas the species does not.
Like in the London plane tree, they have one species, one variety. I think it's.
Is it
Dartmoor?
I think so.
It's resistant to the powdery mildew.
Yeah.
The other varieties get.
And that's why it becomes important sometimes to know those names and know what the names mean. But I was going to say, on the western sycamore, the racemosa, Platanus racemosa, is that the anthracnose gets in and kills the central leader when they're young. And then they grow like this. And then it kills the central leader. And it grows like this.
That's why you see, they look wacky.
And often, the native sycamores, when you come on now, they're 50, 7,500 years old, and they come up and they twist.
Right.
They turn.
They look wacky. They look like there's something seriously wrong. Yeah.
And it's because of the anthracnose. And I get a lot of calls on it in wet springs. I haven't had a lot of calls this year. But I see we have a phone caller, so let's go to our caller. Ed, calling from Highland Park. You're on the air. Go ahead, Ed.
I was calling about your segment earlier on the herbicides and stuff. I have a hard time. I haven't found anything that will take care of ivy. Do you have anything or any suggestions? I've tried multiple applications of Roundup and this and that. And it gets a little thick, but that's as far as it goes.
So he said ivy, right?
I think elbow grease is really good.
Well, in general, what I've done in the past, because, I used to be a landscape contractor. I used to just physically remove it. And that is hard work, but... the idea that you can't physically remove ivy is not correct. You can dig it out. It doesn't root very deep, and it can be dug out. But if that doesn't work, or if you want to spray it and just kill it because it's on a steep slope or for some reason you can't dig it out, then I would try Ortho Brush Be Gone. I don't think that something like Roundup would be effective. The leaves are very waxy and shiny, and I don't think it'll penetrate well. Ivy is really a woody shrub more than it is. It's not herbaceous. It's not a grass. And that's what Roundup is best for. So I would try Ortho Brush Be Gone. And the active ingredient is called triclopyr, and I mentioned it earlier. And that should be very, very effective for ivy. And I didn't mention this earlier, but when you do use an herbicide, be very careful of drift, because if a little bit of it drifts and gets on a plant that's nearby, you're likely to damage that plant. One of the tricks is if you're close to plant material that you don't want to spray, is to put up a piece of plywood or some type of sheeting that would then stop the spray from getting to those plants. And you can edge things quite well if you have a big sheet of either plywood or some type of material that would protect it from drift.
It's interesting you should mention drift, because I just had a case come into the Arboretum where somebody had a rose and it was distorted. It looked hideous. And I remember I mentioned this to you, and it was a question of, is it herbicide damage? And it was far removed from any possible source of herbicide damage. But I had to tell this person, look, when you have an herbicide like Roundup, which damages roses, somebody could spray that during a windy day, and that cloud could go for hundreds of feet.
Oh, yeah. It could, you know, and there have been cases, rather spectacular cases, of drifting more than a mile.
Yes.
And there's been some rather nasty lawsuits in agricultural production over drift going more than a mile.
So remember that. If you're spraying your area with Roundup and it's windy, somebody's roses a mile away could take a hit.
And they won't know who did it to them, but...
Well, that's probably the plus side, but still, it's always a good idea not to have any drift, and also
That's an excellent point, is you should not be spraying herbicides if the wind speed is greater than 5 miles an hour. Typically, that means spraying first thing in the morning, very early in the morning, because usually it's still in the morning. It could be windy, but you're more likely than not to have a nice, cool temperatures and no wind first thing in the morning. And you mentioned, you know, drift is so important. You know, I have a pest control advisor's license, and you do too, I believe.
Yeah.
So we can write recommendations for the application of pesticides in agricultural production. And if you don't know, if the audience doesn't know, pesticides are highly regulated in California. Anything sold in California called a pesticide has to be registered with the United States Environmental Protection Agency and the California Department of Pesticide Regulation. You have to file the label rules. There's a million rules. You have to have training annually for anyone doing the applications. It goes on and on and on and on. Nothing is more regulated than pesticide application. And
except if you're a homeowner.
Well, if you're a homeowner, you can do almost anything.
Yeah.
But you can't let it go off your property. You can't mix up your own brew and then splash it into your neighbor's yard. That's not allowed.
Absolutely.
So, but homeowners are allowed to do a lot of things that commercial production, you know, ag production is not allowed to do. But, and now I've
oh, we're talking about spray. We're talking about spray. And
we're talking about spray, right. And
how to
now
get
completely.
Well, I can't answer that. As far as like herbicides go, there's a lot of other ways to apply herbicides besides using a spray. And one of the better ways to apply herbicide, especially in an ivy situation, is you can put the herbicide on a sponge and sponge it on the leaves, and it's translocated into the
plant. If you had a small area to do, that would be
right.
Possible. But
yeah, large hillside.
Now, if I had a small area, I would tend not to use an herbicide. I would just go out with a shovel and a spade and fork, and I would tear it out.
Oh, absolutely, because even the triclopyr can leave some of them alive.
Well, you know, even after you spray it and it dies, you've got to go tear it out.
Right.
I assume you're going to replant it with something.
Well, you know what happens if you leave, in some areas here in Southern California, if you leave wood down in the ground, what happens? You get a malaria problem.
Well, if it's already there, yeah.
Yeah.
But subterranean termites love buried wood, any
yeah.
type of buried wood. So you're probably better off tearing it all out, turning the soil, and then starting with your new plant material.
Oh, absolutely.
But what I wanted to say earlier that I completely forgot was that I've written pest control advisories for our department, the department I work in full-time, which is the Agricultural Commissioner Weights and Measures Department for Los Angeles County, because we do a lot of roadside weed control. A lot of people don't know that anybody who is in charge of taking care of roads, Caltrans, the county, cities, they are required to maintain the shoulders weed-free. It's a fire code. So the county and Caltrans have thousands of miles of roads, and in the rural areas, you get all these weeds growing along the shoulders.
Aren't enough community service people, are there?
And so they spray, and they apply herbicides.
Right.
And so often we need a written recommendation in order to do that. So I have written those recommendations, and the number one thing I write on my recommendations is do not spray when the wind speed exceeds 5 miles per hour.
Now, do they listen?
Yes, because we're scared to death of drift. We are scared to death of drift.
I would be too. I mean, just think
because we're financially responsible, or anybody spraying.
Well, yeah, if you're a homeowner, if you're spraying that herbicide and your neighbor can prove that you killed her roses,
then you're going to order some roses.
Yes.
And you, hopefully you only kill a couple. If it drifts over there and it wipes out her lawn, replacing a lawn can be fairly expensive.
You can get up in the thousands of
thousands
dollars.
Thousands of dollars. Yeah. So be very, very careful when you're using herbicides. Make sure you don't get drift. Spray when the wind speed is less than 5 miles.
And there's a lot of strategies you can do that will kind of even circumvent the use of herbicides.
Well, you don't always need to use them. In fact, that's what integrated pest management is all about. You don't go in and find and take out your most toxic material first. You look at what you can do that has the least impact. The whole point of integrated pest management was to reduce the amount of pesticides used in
the. You were talking about the highways. I've noticed they started mulching the highways with the green waste.
With chip.
Right.
And in fact, one of the things that they were doing at the Arboretum, not the Arboretum, I mean the Huntington recently, to kill Bermuda. Uh-huh. Now, Bermuda is really hard to get rid of
if
you don't spray it. They were putting it on cardboard and then burying that in about 4 to 6 inches of mulch. And they were putting on, you know, they were overlapping the cardboard and then that shades it. It works really well. You can come back.
Now, we've been mulching at the Arboretum now for almost, since 2000. 2002, and we were using something like 1,200 pounds of Roundup before we mulched.
You're using
now we're down to about 100 pounds. So
you've reduced it by more than 90%.
Right.
Just by using mulch. And mulch is actually a great way to control.
The place looks better.
It looks better as it decomposes. It does all sorts of good things for the soil. Now mulch is almost.
That was Tim Phillips' idea, by the way.
And it's a good idea,
and
a good maybe his idea to do it there, but somebody figured it out a long time ago.
Yeah.
I don't know who, but wood chip and mulch, increasing the organic content in your soil is key to healthy plants. So it increases drainage.
Mm-hmm.
You have a slow release of fertilizers and nutrients into the soil. It suppresses weeds.
Have you seen what they're doing? You were talking about cardboard, and have you seen what they're doing with these permaculture gardens? They'll make mounds and then have swales to collect rainwater. And on top of the mounds, which are made of mostly compost and some soil, they'll put cardboard. And on top of the cardboard, they'll put straw. And so you get this great mulching activity going on. It increases the moisture. It decreases the weeds. And apparently with the permaculture, and this is with regular agriculture as long as you put lots of organic material in the soil, you get fungus that will come out of that compost into the soil and create channels for water to come up into the
garden. Yeah, I'd be surprised.
It's amazing.
That it has so many benefits for the soil. But what else is new at the Arboretum? Your plant sale must be coming up in May?
We have a plant sale. We're not doing the huge show.
You're not doing the garden show this year?
Not this year, no. We're going to do that. We're going to do that every other year. We're giving it that way we can make it bigger and better. But we are having a plant sale, and that's coming up on April 2nd and 3rd.
April 2nd and 3rd?
We call
that's
it
a
our
Saturday
giant
Sunday?
Sale.
That's April 2nd and 3rd. That's a Saturday, Sunday?
Probably, yes. Check your calendars out there. But I look over the preliminary list of what's going to be available, and we're going to have a lot of Australian plants, especially from I think Australian native plants nurseries and a few other places.
Are the nurseries coming in and setting up booths?
Some of the nurseries are coming in. I don't know if they're setting up booths, but they're going to have their plants available. I'm going to be available in my plant information staff to answer any questions about the plants, and believe me, we're very questionable over there. But it's going to be really good. We're going to have some great plants. You're going to be supporting the Arboretum. A lot of plants you don't normally see. And 2nd and 3rd on April.
So what's blooming at the Arboretum right now? Somebody comes to the Arboretum.
The magnolias look fantastic. It's a really good year for magnolias. Because of the cool weather, they put on more buds than usual. The amount of buds has to do with how much cool weather they have. The cooler the weather in the summer, the more buds they put on. These things have put on an incredible amount of buds.
And so, are they in full bloom right now?
Oh, yeah. It's spectacular.
And that's down there right by the waterfall?
By the waterfall in the southern part. They call that area the Meadowbrook section. There is also in bloom, coming in bloom right now, are the pink trumpet trees.
Yeah,
they're starting to come into bloom.
Oh, yeah.
And when they hit peak, which will be about a month from now, the place will look outstanding.
The funny thing is where I have my laboratory in Southgate.
Mm-hmm.
we had a carrot wood that was damaging the pavement, so we tore it out and we put in a pink comfit tree, which is Tabebuia impetigosa.
Great street trees.
And they're great street trees. They're just so pretty. They're fabulous. So we put one in there, but it's in full bloom right now.
Oh, my God.
And the reason is it's got a huge white wall, and it faces the south. And it's got concrete all around it, so it's really warm.
Yeah.
And it breaks, you know, it's a good month before all the other pink trumpet trees will bloom. But the Magnolia slanogiennis, the tulip trees, how many different cultivars do you guys have? You have quite a few.
I think we have about, well, on paper there's probably about 30 or 40 something.
30,
like
40
that,
different named varieties.
Right, but that's on paper. And
that include the species too? Because you've got some unusual species
right.
In addition to slanogiennis.
We have one, and I can't remember the name of it, sorry, but it is in the herb garden, and it has the largest flowers
I've ever seen. It has flowers the size of a dinner plate.
And I can't remember.
We
spent a long time trying to find the name. We found the name. It's not a very common one.
How did you
one.
Find the name? Because when I was there, Jim told me that he didn't know what species it was.
Well, apparently they have that over at the Arnold Arboretum. They have specimens of that. I think we found out through the Arnold
because that was a spectacular, and that's one that maybe you guys should propagate. And because no one's picking it up.
Oh, it's gorgeous. But it's a big tree for one of the flowering magnolias. It's a lot larger than the other flowering magnolias.
Well, I've seen sometimes the slanogiennis will get pretty big over time, but it does take a long, long time. Here is a question. Is it a good strategy to paint a wall white to increase light absorbed by plants? Yes and no. I mean, it would work. The point is that if you have a large white wall facing the south during this, and it gets full sun, it reflects a lot of light, and it gets very, very hot. And so if you grow things right there, you have to be very careful what you grow there because they have to be incredibly tolerant of that type of heat, especially in the hot part of the summer. So things like bougainvillea, hibiscus, they do well up against southern facing walls.
Some things don't, like podocarpus. I've had some podocarpus come in all burned from, it's the weather and the fact that they're up against the wall.
But, there at the Arboretum, we had when I was at the, I keep interchanging Arboretum and the Huntington. I was at the Huntington, and we had a big white-facing wall facing south on the library.
So what did you grow on there?
And they had a bunch of azaleas they'd put in there.
Ooh.
And it cooked them.
Yeah.
It didn't.
Ooh.
I don't know. They didn't ask me what I thought about planting those there. But after about six, they put them in the spring. They were doing okay. And then here came September.
Oh, what about the floating azaleas over at the Getty?
That looks like a maintenance nightmare.
They get cooked too. I mean, the water reflects the light.
Yeah, but the water itself probably cools. You know, I don't think they have a problem so much with the heat right there. I think they just, when I look at that, I think that is a maintenance nightmare. And they have to go out there in waders to take care of those things. And they probably replace a lot of them.
It does look kind of cool.
It's kind of cool. What Frank is mentioning is if you've been to the Getty has a rather unusual garden. It doesn't really have a theme like a lot of gardens might have a theme. It's more of an eclectic mixture of plants that the designer liked.
I like how the plants meander and the stream shoots straight through.
Yeah. And that stream doesn't look much like a stream, but looks more like a flood control channel to me. I guess I'm a little critical of that garden because it just...
Well, there goes your grant from the Getty.
Well, I'm sorry. That garden... It's got nice plant materials, but it's just that was not designed by a landscape architect. And you
it was designed by an artist.
Yeah, an artist who was not a landscape architect,
right.
And you can tell. And you tell he was learning as he went. But
we're talking about the
you know, so what he's talking about is when you get down to the very bottom, you follow the trail down, and you get down to the lowest part of the garden, there's a waterfall and a water thing, and in the middle of it is this spiral arms of azaleas. And the first thing I thought about when I saw that is how are you going to manage, because I'm always maintenance oriented, how are you going to take care of those azaleas? They're high maintenance plants. You're always doing something to the azaleas to keep them alive. They die from root rot, they get thrips, they go yellow from iron deficiency.
Here in Southern California, I don't think I've ever seen an azalea make it past 10 years.
Well, if you take care of them, you've got to be very proactive. I have azaleas at home. I have to treat them for root rot regularly.
What do you use?
I use Fosgard, which is
Agrifos.
Well, Agrifos is a labeled fungicide. It's a phosphonate. It's, you know, a phosphorus acid product. Mm-hmm. Fosgard is a fertilizer.
Oh, that's right. Yes.
And here's, you know, it's labeled as a fertilizer, but it, everyone knows, because it's widely used in citrus and avocado production, and everyone knows that they're really not using it as a fertilizer. They're using it to control phytophthora.
I've got a quick question for you, though. Where can you get Fosgard?
From
J.H. Home Gardener.
You call up J.H. Biotech in Ventura, and they'll give you the name of a distributor.
Oh, they have retail distributors?
Not so much retail, but it, you know, you've got to, you know, make the effort to go get it. They'll sell it to you. When I first ordered it, I got
like
it directly from
Whittier Fertilizer. Have it?
They may carry it, but when I first got it, I ordered it directly from JH Biotech, and they shipped it to me. Now I hear.
How much did you have to buy to get them shipped back?
2.5 gallon jug. It's $30 a gallon.
And how much would a normal homeowner use?
A gallon would probably last you 5 years.
Oh, that's not bad at all.
So $30 compared to going out and buying something like Agrifos, right, which would be, you know, quite a bit more.
Not cheap.
It's all labeled.
And
of course, the first product was, of all the phosphorus acid products that control phytophthora root rot, was Aliette. And Aliette is an aluminum salt of phosphorus acid. It's called phosphatyl aluminum is the active ingredient.
And nasty stuff.
Not really.
No, you get it.
Very low
toxicity. It's low toxicity, but it really stings and dries you up if you get in your
eyes.
But
don't get this stuff on your skin. I was mentioning earlier, don't get this stuff.
No. It's not good.
Keep it off you.
Yeah.
You don't have to use it as a spray. You can use it just as a drench. And you can mix it up in a bucket and then pour it on. But so when that was introduced in the early 80s, Aliette was introduced. The company that introduced it, Rompelon, which was a French pharmaceutical and ag chemical company, had a use patent for phosphorus acid to control as a fungicide. And so they knew that phosphorus acid was what was controlling the root rot. And so people started just using phosphorus acid. And then in the late 90s, there were some papers out of UCR that said you could use phosphorus acid as a fertilizer. And then very soon after that, several companies started selling phosphorus acid fertilizers, primarily to the citrus and avocado industry. And the sales of Ritamil and Aliette probably went down rather dramatically, because now you're paying $30 a gallon as opposed to paying $650 a gallon.
Well, aren't those type of fungicides much more effective than, say, Ritamil or Subdue anyway?
No, Ritamil and Subdue are of course, they're the same thing. Those are two labels,
right,
for the active ingredient. It's called, my brain just didn't work very good today.
Okay.
But Ritamil and Subdue are, Subdue is the ornamental label, Ritamil is the ag label, and it controls phytophthora root rot. They're very effective, except there has been resistance in phytophthora to that product.
Right.
If you use it for a long time, like in potato, where they get a late blighted potato, a phytophthora disease, or if you use it for a long time in a citrus orchard and you're not rotating to other types of products. But, you know, no one should depend on these chemicals entirely for their control. You know, we're talking about integrated pest management. If you're talking about root rot and controlling root rot, the number one means to control root rot is your frequency of irrigation.
Mm-hmm.
You want to soak the soil and then let it dry for a period of time until it really needs to be watered again. That could be 1 week, 2, 3, up to 4 weeks.
Gypsum, too.
Your irrigation frequency, this is your IPM for phytophthora root rot. Your frequency of irrigation, gypsum. You put down 1/4 inch of gypsum underneath your fruit tree twice a year. So if you're talking about citrus or avocado or any fruit trees or azaleas or any of them, you put down about 1/4 inch of gypsum, which is calcium sulfate. The high calcium levels will inhibit the phytophthora. Then about 3 or 4 inches of mulch twice a year, spring and the fall, with the gypsum. As the mulch decomposes, it inhibits phytophthora root rot, another benefit of mulching. And then if you're still losing azaleas, if you still have, if your tree appears to have root rot or you know it has root rot, then you can use the chemicals. Typically what I tell people is that you can, if your tree is in severe decline, you're trying to save it, then you're going to use the chemical either on a monthly or every 2 or 3 months, depending on which chemical you choose and how strong you use it. But you're going to use it for maybe a year until the tree starts to recover. And once it starts to recover, then you should be able to depend on your cultural practices to keep it under control.
Well, plus, here's an interesting thing. If you've been gardening in Southern California for more than 10 to 20 years, you've basically been farming Phytophthora, because most of the, unfortunately, most of the cheaper nursery container plants you buy are just loaded with it because of the type of soil hygiene some of the low-priced growers do, and as a result, every time you bring in a new kind of cheap plant, you're bringing in lots of Phytophthora.
You might be. Absolutely.
Yeah. And
Phytophthora is very difficult to keep out of nursery production.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the practices I've seen in nurseries where they may actually use a new pot. They get clean pots.
I'm not talking about high-end places. I'm talking about, you know, under the power lines.
But even the high-end places, they'll go to great expense to use brand-new pots.
Right.
Potting mixes that are clean. They're not contaminated. And then they'll take them and set them right on the soil.
Right.
And then when it rains hard, the soil has Phytophthora spores in it.
Mm-hmm.
The rain hits the soil. It splashes into the pot. Now you've got the Phytophthora in the pot.
Well, especially when you have a lot of pots growing on the soil.
You got to put down gravel. You got to put down a plastic material, something to prevent the soil from splashing into the pots.
So you can see how hard it is for the nursery people to control the Phytophthora. And so
it is hard.
And you've got a lot of Phytophthora being brought into gardens.
Here's the other problem is it can actually be in your irrigation water, which then makes – then you've got to do some –
Really? Like L.A. City?
No. You know, tap water, no.
Not tap water.
But if you're one of the big nurseries out in Azusa, well, it was Monrovia Nursery, used to draw their water from the Santa Ana River.
Uh-huh.
You could bait Phytophthora out of the river. Because it was washing into the stream.
Ah.
So if you're pumping water out of a river,
right.
If you're pumping water out of a pond, it's very easy to have Phytophthora in that situation. If you're taking well water, it's far less likely. But, you know, Monrovia used to treat their water with ozone.
Well, plus, containers themselves are just beautiful incubators for Phytophthora.
And then there's the other problem, is that the containers are particularly problematic because the bottom of the pots stay so wet. So there you go. You got
What I did with my house is I had Phytophthora problems with the azaleas, and I figured it's on everything else. And so I applied it to the entire area, and it was amazing how things grew after that. It was like you took a weight off of them.
Absolutely. It is quite remarkable to see the difference between a plant that where you've controlled the Phytophthora root rot and plants you haven't. And a lot of times you won't really see that your plant is stunted and not growing very fast because you don't have a healthy plant next to it to compare it to.
Right.
You won't see it until the tips start to die. It starts to turn yellow, and now it's in severe decline, and the chances of saving it aren't that great.
I mean, a lot of people will feel kind of funny about using a chemical like
Subdue
to take care of the Phytophthora, but if you think about it, it's a man-made situation that there's that much Phytophthora in the first place.
Absolutely.
So it's up to us to get it back down to where it was.
I think one of the main reasons that you do see so much root rot and Phytophthora root rot in particular throughout gardens in Southern California is people's horrible watering practices. I can't tell you how many times people call me up and say they're watering every day. Don't water every day. Nothing needs to be watered every day. You know, right now it's spring. Most of your plants and shrubs and trees can be watered once or twice a month. A good deep soak, let them dry out for a few weeks. If you're watering two, three times a week, you know, on shrubs and trees, it's way too frequent, and then you're going to have the Phytophthora problems. Now, I want to remind our audience that our guest today is Frank McDonough, and if you have a question about the Arboretum, give us a call, and we'll do our best to answer it. Frank, of course, is the plant information specialist.
Well, he's got a great title, Botanical Information Consultant. Don't you just love it?
Botanical Information Consultant. Los Angeles County.
$25 could not buy a better title.
And Botanic Garden in Arcadia. And how long have you been there, Frank?
12 years.
12 years. And Frank has a long history in horticulture. He used to manage an Armstrong.
Right, and I've been in horticulture since I was in my early 20s.
And you have a degree in hort, right?
Yeah, a degree in botany.
You have a degree in botany from?
Cal Poly Pomona.
Cal Poly Pomona.
Yeah.
So I have a alma mater as well. I have a degree in botany from Cal Poly.
That's right.
What do you know?
You know, by the way, not to change the subject, but I love talking about me. But you see, at the Arboretum, we had the mycological fair, the mushroom fair.
Oh, the mushroom fair was
It was fantastic. A lot of people were there. Now, just their luck, we had this huge amount of dry weather just before the show.
I know. When it rained so hard back in, when was it?
Right. There were mushrooms coming up all over the place.
It was a great drenching, and it looked like it was going to be a wet winter. And now it hasn't rained for weeks and weeks, and then they have the mushroom fair. Did they have a lot of materials out
there? No, but they had some interesting stuff. In fact, there was a bumper crop of Amanita
You know, Ammonitis.
Bad Ammonita, not the good Ammonita.
Ammonitis tend to...
Those are called death angels for everybody that's out there. Well, death angels, they're very deadly poisonous.
Some of the Ammonitis, yeah.
Yes.
Pantherina and Ocriata.
No, they had Zocriata.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, they had the bumper crop of Ocriata.
And then, you know why? Is because Ammonita tends to fruit more heavily in dry years.
Really?
In really wet years, like if we have an El Nino and we get like 30, 40 inches of rain in the Pasadena area in San Gabriel Valley, you don't see very much Ammonita.
So that's why after that dry period, there were so many of them.
It got good and soaked, and then we were dry, and then you're going to see...
That's why, if you're a mushroom collector out there, just warning, there's some really bad Ammonita out there. Watch out for it. Be sure if you have any white gilled mushrooms...
What else do we have to talk about at the Arboretum? What else? What's this?
I'm doing a tour called Around the World with 127 Acres, where I look at different aspects of our collection. For instance, sugar and spice and everything nice looks at different types of spices. Plants that change the world. Plants like sugarcane, tobacco, they've had major geopolitical effects on people.
Absolutely.
We're here. I'm here because of plants. That would be the potato, which failed miserably for 3 years in a row because of Phytophthora infestans. Right.
Late blighted potato.
We're going to be looking at all those and the plants we have in our collection and how important they are to human history and how they've changed the world and how they relate to us personally at the present moment. Because you'd be surprised how much these plants have affected your past and why you're here.
So have you done a genealogy? Have you gone back and looked? Do you know when your family immigrated to the United States?
Yeah, about right that time.
Right after the
birth? Somewhat afterwards, yes.
Because that was a plant disease, a late blighted potato. It was one of the central causes of the Irish potato famine.
Well, they relied on one variety called the lumper.
And it was highly susceptible.
Right, but it was huge. Interesting thing about tomato potatoes is you could grow on a small plot enough potatoes to feed a family of 10 for years.
Yes, and so they became very reliant. The poorest, you know, the peasants, or I guess is the right term I want to use, became reliant on potato in Ireland. And the disease actually had broken out way before 1845. It had little outbreaks in the 1820s and in Europe.
The conditions were good 3 years in a row.
It rained and rained. And then they had wiped out the potato crop. But here's the most, far more important, really, was that there was plenty of food in Ireland. They were exporting it.
The
English landlords.
It was a political situation.
They should have prohibited the export of all foods out of Ireland when that happened, and they didn't. And they let the people starve, and a million people starved to death. And at the same time, they were evicting people off the land. So there are some who really look at that as a genocide by the English against the Irish, and I'd have to agree with that. It was not just the disease. I see that it's time for us to say goodbye. Our time's up. I want to thank our guest, Frank McDonough from the Arboretum, and thank everyone for viewing, and we'll see you next week.